everyone and welcome back to my channel. My name is Ezgi and I'm a GP trainee in a North London hospital. I've had a long journey into medical school. I was rejected from 8 medical schools in total before I finally secured a place at UCL. So if you're going through a rejection at the moment or if you're anticipating rejection, you don't know what to do and you don't know what to do next, I got you. But before we head into the video, don't forget to subscribe. And if you like the video, please give it a thumbs up. I do lots of videos about my life as a doctor. So I vlog my shifts at work and at home. And I do lots of sit down videos answering your questions and also talking to you about my journey into medical school, how to get work experience and all of those sorts of stuff. So the most logical thing to do at this moment is to sit back and to think about why I got these rejections. And in hindsight now, when I look back, I can see so many faults with my application, with the way I went about it and how I prepared. So these are the reasons why I got rejected from medical school 8 times. Firstly, I aimed really high and I chose really competitive medical schools when I was applying on my UCAS form. At the time, so even now, I'm living in London and I wanted to, you know, be at home, be with my family. I didn't want to move out. And I thought, you know, the London universities are really prestigious and you're going to be a better doctor if you're here. And I had the false impression that if I went to medical school in London, that I would secure a place as a doctor in London after I graduated. And this simply isn't true. I clearly saw myself as like the new hotshot medical school applicant, and that was the best thing out there. So I needed to apply to all of the best universities. And that really got me in the end, because yes, my application was average and my grades were average, but I wouldn't say I was a better student out there at all. And in hindsight, if I could, I would have varied my university choices. I would have chosen some outside of London, some with even lower entrance scores, those with different entrance exams, which I'll go into as well. So like I said, that leads on to my second point. And that is, when I applied, I chose universities that mainly had the same entrance exam. And for me at the time, that was the UCAT. 3 out of my 4 choices accepted the UCAT exam. So what did I go and do? I flopped the exam really badly. And I knew from then on that I didn't really have a chance of getting into those 3 universities. And so when I look back, what I should have done is really balanced the number of universities that were accepting these entrance exams. I would have chose 2 universities that accepted the BMAT and 2 that accepted the UCAT. In case I failed one of them, then I had the other one to bank on to do a little bit better on and have a chance. Because as you'll probably know, you only have 4 options of medical schools to choose from. And so having 3 of them already written off is a big chunk just gone. So I did sit the BMAT and I actually got an average score in the essay part and the science part, etc. But because the rest of my application was just a bit average and a bit meh, I didn't really get accepted or even got an interview for that university that I went for. Which again leads us very nicely onto the next point, which is, do not underestimate the importance of entrance exams. Now, there are some universities who don't really care about the entrance exam and use it at the point where there's a tie between 2 students and they want to use it as a tie break, or they put emphasis on your personal statement first and then your interview and then the UCAT if they want to add any more value to your application. But a lot of the universities do use the UCAT and the BMAT as a way of deciding if you should get an interview in the first place. Now, when I first applied and applied the second time and the third time, I didn't prepare for the UCAT very well first time around. What I did was I got a book with some questions and I thought that I familiarized myself with the exam format and how to answer the questions and how to go about it. And I thought, yeah, this is easy. I know, you know, the maths is so simple. It's like fractions and multiplications, anyways, and that sort of stuff. So I went into the exam and yes, the questions weren't that bad, but the timing really got me. I was so stuck for time. I was looking at the time, then panicking. Then because I was panicking, I wasn't able to focus on the question. And because I wasn't able to focus on the question, I was panicking and I was in this vicious circle. And I don't know how I got to the end of the exam, but I ended up getting to the end. And obviously I got a really bad score. So even though I prepared for the types of questions, I didn't really prepare well in terms of my timing. So you need to really give yourself enough time to sit down, familiarize yourself with the questions, get the timing right. Remember that this exam is on the computer, so there's a lot of wasted time on like clicking and even the calculators on the computer. So you can't just, you know, get one of those handheld ones and just quickly do your calculation. It's all on the screen. So get yourself used to that and don't underestimate it, would be my advice. And to add to that as well, if you want to watch my video and how I prepared for the UCAT and BMAT, then I'll put the link in the description below. I'll refer to lots of videos in this video because I've done lots of detailed videos about each section. So if you want to sort of go away once you've watched this video and watch in detail about other aspects of your application, then please feel free to do that. Now, the fourth reason that I've worked out as to why I didn't get into medical school those 8 times, and you think that I'd learned my lesson, I thought I did, but obviously I haven't, is to diversify my work experience. So as my young, naive self at 18, I was quite adamant that I needed work experience in a hospital. And I got this 4-day long work experience where this hospital put us on different placements and we got to shadow different doctors and go into surgeries and all this cool stuff. But I totally disregarded the other aspects of community work where medical teams were also working. So things like GP practices, nursing homes, care homes, hospices, outpatient clinics. There's so many other places that you can gain work experience from apart from the inside of the hospital walls. So had I diversified my experience and really grasped what I should have understood from that placement, I would have done so much better. Because I went in with the mind frame of, oh, today I watched surgery. Today I saw, you know, an unwell patient being given medication by the nurse. But what I really should have focused on is the workings of the ward, the shifts of the doctor, what difficulties they face, any ethical issues they come across, the pathway of the patient through the NHS. So like, you know, go to the GP, be referred to hospital, come to an outpatient clinic. That's the kind of things I really should have focused on rather than just the physical things I was doing on my placement. And as well, I've got a whole video on this topic that I'll link in the description about how to get work experience and how to make use of your work experience placement as well. And the last reason why I failed to get into medical school was that I didn't prepare well enough for my interviews. Now, I was quite shy at the time. I didn't really tell other people that I was preparing for an interview. So I read some online forums, I read some articles, you know, got my head around the recent news around healthcare and sort of mentally prepared for the interview. I spoke out loud and, you know, just in my head answered the questions and was like, yeah, that's what I'm gonna say if they ask me that. That's what I'm gonna say if they ask me this. But there's so much to the interview than just the answers that you give. Your body language, how you come across and how you compose yourself is as important as the answers that you give in the interview. So in hindsight, what I should have done is confided in my close friend and said, you know what? You might not know anything about medical school and its application process, but can you help me? Just ask me these questions, look at the way I answer them. Could I have worded them a bit better? How was my body language? Did I look closed off? Was I frowning? Because I have a resting bitch face. And sometimes it comes across very rude, but honestly, it's just my resting face and I have no control over it sometimes. So having someone to just sit there and say, you know what, like your posture was just very closed off, you know, so you should sit back a little bit, maybe have a bit of like a smile on your face. Those things really do change the atmosphere for your interview. So don't underestimate how important that is. So those are the 5 reasons why I think I got rejected from medical school 8 times. Now, when I look back, I did do better in each application. Obviously, I finally got in, so I must have done something right. But if you're in the situation that I was in how many years ago where I felt stuck, I didn't know what to do with my life, medicine is all I wanted to do, so I was just like, I just felt empty and I just felt scared because I was like, okay, so what do I do now? I just don't know what to do with my skills. I don't know what to do with my grades. This is all I ever wanted. So what happens now? And for that, I've got lots of tips for you. Another thing I'd like to tell you is that if you want to have a read of my personal statement that I used during my final application that got me 4 offers, I'll link it in the description below. You can use it as a guide. Obviously with UCAS, they have plagiarism detection. So if you read my personal statement and you copy any aspects of that, that will be flagged. So use it as a guide. So what do you do if you've been rejected from medical school? You've got lots of options and there is no right one. Let me tell you that. It really depends on you, your personal circumstances, and you might choose the wrong one at first, but trust me, you'll stumble across things and it will eventually work out, which is what happened with me. So the first option you can take is to do a gap year. Now, a gap year, the main purpose of this is if you've got your grades, you know, your grades aren't the issue, but you want to diversify your work experience. Now, you can do this by going abroad, you know, joining projects that do lots of healthcare campaigning, building schools and for underprivileged communities. It's a little bit difficult in this climate at the moment, but hopefully by the time you get around to finishing off whatever you've done this year, and you know, when September comes in, if you want to take a gap year, hopefully things should have settled down by then. But if you want to stay in the UK, which is what I did in my gap year, then you can find work and work experience in that year to really add value to your application. For example, working in a pharmacy, working as a healthcare assistant, or just if you don't have any financial issues, you can really do volunteering work, you know, and do long-term placement, a whole year's worth, to really tell the admissions tutors that, you know, you're serious about this and you've really taken time out and you're really taking this seriously. Now, the second option, obviously, if you have got poor grades, is to retake your A-levels. But be careful with this because not every university will accept applicants who have taken more than 2 years to complete their A-levels. Now, this only really matters if, for example, your application, everything else was fine, your work experience was pristine, but your A-levels really let you down. It's an option that not many people take, and I haven't heard many people taking a year out to, you know, boost their A-levels and then finally apply to get in. If it's the case, normally what people do is take a gap year maybe and apply for universities with foundation years where you do an extra year and where they boost you up in terms of your medical knowledge before they put you into the main program, or do a graduate degree first, which is exactly what I did after my gap year. I didn't get in again, so I decided I'm going to do a whole other degree. But please only do this undergraduate degree if it's really going to be plan B for you, if it's actually going to be a career that you consider yourself doing. So don't just do it as a stepping stone into medicine. Do it because if medicine doesn't work out, you're going to be as happy doing that other career. So for me, for example, I chose biomedical sciences, and there's this funny thing going around that like people who do biomedical sciences are medical school rejects, and actually they're just doing that degree to get into medicine. But trust me, by the time final year came around, there was only a handful of us really applying for medical school, and I was one of them. And if I didn't get into medicine again, I was quite happy that I was going to go away with my degree. I was going to do a postgraduate in teaching, and I was going to become a science teacher. And I was quite content with that and I was happy. I didn't really like the research side of the degree, so I wasn't really interested in doing a PhD and a master's, for example. I was going to go into teaching and that was going to be my thing. But luckily for me, when I applied third time round as a graduate student, I got in. The whole point of that story is that if you're going to do undergraduate medicine, always keep in the back of your mind that it might not even happen then. So whatever degree you end up going into, ensure that it's something you're happy with. And again, I have a whole video on this about getting into graduate entry medicine, about the funding and everything like that. So that's it, guys. That's why I failed to get into medical school 8 times, but I'm here as a qualified doctor in GP training and I live to tell you my story. So if you're in a similar situation, if you've gone through any of the 8 rejections that I've gone through, I know how it feels, but there is light at the end of the tunnel. Don't fret. Reflection is the most important thing. Reflect back at your application. Really sit down and think, if I was an admissions tutor, what was wrong with my application? What can I change? And really take time to think about the points that you can improve, but because it's only then that you can make changes that will allow you to get into medical school. As always, please, please subscribe if you have not already. I'd love for you to join my channel and my community. I go back to work in a couple of weeks. I'm on maternity leave at the moment, if you don't know, and there'll be lots of hospital vlogs coming up. And give this video a thumbs up because it really helps me reach other people like yourself. And I'll see you in my next video. Bye.